Hi, and welcome to the show, where we share the stories of the many who intersect with our healthcare system, but are rarely heard from. My name is Kevin Pho, founder and editor of KevinMD. Today on the show, we have Art Williams. He's a general surgeon, and he's the author of The Surgeon's Obel. Art, welcome to the show.
Hey, thanks very much, Kevin. Thanks for having me.
So we'll get into your book in a little bit, but first off, can you share your story and your journey to where you are today?
Sure. I'm a general surgeon in Cincinnati, Ohio. I work for the VA Medical Center there. I'm a general surgeon who does primarily bread and butter general surgery, but I also do some dialysis, vascular access, and have a good practice there at the VA.
Fantastic. And we're speaking in the middle of September. How is the pandemic affecting you and your practice?
Well, things have slowed down. There's a lot of cautious preparation for worries about the pandemic worsening. So we've slowed down a little bit, but we're still at about, I'd say, the half the volume that we usually do. But it's still an all hands on deck kind of approach to the pandemic, even at this point.
Now, from a general surgery standpoint, what kind of COVID-related cases are you seeing?
Well, thankfully, we're not seeing a lot of COVID-related general surgery issues. Mainly, it's sparingly, we do see some emergency procedures, but it's mainly just cutting back on our general surgery or doing kind of the emergency or urgent cases that need to be done and kind of letting the more bread and butter things wait until things have cleared a little bit.
So let's talk about your book, The Surgeon's Obel, and you submitted a KevinMD excerpt for that. It's called The First Night on Call as a Surgery Intern. Now, for those who haven't read your excerpt or your book, can you walk my audience through it and share the story of why you decided to write it?
I began it as kind of almost decompressive therapy for some of the stresses that surgeons often see. It's about an intern in surgery, and it's through the eyes of a young female intern who enters a program a lot like the program that I went to. And it was very a very stressful 7-year program. In that time of surgery residency, there's a lot of things that you see that can really affect you down the road. There's especially if you see a lot of trauma, and one of the things we saw a lot of was burns and pediatric burns, and that type of patient population, I don't know how the nurses and the burn unit and things can be so dedicated to what they do, but there was one case in particular that affected me. And like most kind of macho surgeons, we kind of try to squelch that uncomfortable feelings sometimes that you have, and it comes back later to kind of haunt you. So the book was written to kind of almost as a decompressive therapy to kind of get me thinking about things that happened and writing it down to make it kind of concrete, to some ways deal with some of the horrific things that I saw as a resident.
Share some of the stories that in the book that particularly affected you, or I guess your protagonist in the book.
Yeah, I can remember one case particularly. There was a bad case of this young kid, 3 or 4 or 5 years old, who came in with a horrific case of purpura fulminans and just had extensive mottling and ischemia of all of the extremities. And we had to do amputations of his just little kid's hands. It should be out, you know, skipping puddles and throwing rocks. And here we are, you know, amputating this awful, awful case of purpura fulminans. And so I talk about that in the book a little bit, how that affects a person, knowing that things like that are out there. It affects you maybe not wanting to even have kids. And she talks about that thing in the book.
And can you share how writing has helped you through some of these difficult times during your surgery training and as your career as a surgeon evolved?
Well, one of the things, I'll go back a little bit. My father was a surgeon as well, and he was a transplant surgeon and actually kind of trained under the father of liver transplantation, Dr. Thomas Starzl. Growing up with that kind of a background, I knew I wanted to do surgery in medical school, but I knew I didn't want to follow that path. So for me, surgery has been a career that's allowed me to do the things outside of the hospital that I've been interested in. So hobbies like writing mm-hmm. and woodworking and other things that have kind of motivated me to decompress in other ways. And I think a very important thing for surgeons to really, really think hard about doing is finding some way to decompress from the stresses of the OR and the intensive care unit. For me, it's been a way to do other surgery, and being at the in a government hospital has allowed me to really have some time off to pursue things that maybe some other surgeons don't get a chance to do or don't have the time. I think that's pretty important as a decompressive therapy. The writing in and of itself, like I said, it gets you to really hash through some of these emotions and putting it down on the page mm-hmm. and then going back and editing it. It really solidifies your feelings and your experiences that previously were kind of nebulous and maybe eating at you a little bit. But by getting it down on the page, it's almost like talking to a therapist without the copay.
Whenever you think about surgery training, there's a stereotype associated with it.
Sure.
Endless nights, always on call, difficult cases. Now, has surgery training changed today compared to what you went through when you trained?
Yeah, I think it definitely has changed. And you can argue whether it's for good, all for good, or all for bad. I think by and large, it's been for the good, especially for the emotional health and even the physical health of the trainees. My time during residency was very, very tough. We were, I hate to be the old guy, get off my lawn kind of a thing, but it was too brutal. I think they've got a relatively good balance of training versus, you know, kind of being out of the hospital. It's incredibly important to get out of the hospital. I mean, when I was a chief resident, we were on call 365 days of the year. I mean, we unless you're on vacation and even some guys wouldn't even take vacation. You never got a chance to really decompress. And I think that's for the better. Some would argue that maybe there's not as much time in the operating room, but I think people are working around that. They're doing extra training afterwards, or if they really want to pursue something surgically demanding, they'll get a little bit more training.
Now, what do you see are some of the challenges facing the specialty today?
Well, I think finding that balance is still a challenge. Especially when you get into practice and you have maybe a busy private practice, it's very difficult. Once you kind of get a routine set and get a practice set where you're very, very busy, it's hard to go in reverse. There are a lot of people that are looking at kind of work-life balance. I think there's an investigator named Carol Ann Moulton in Toronto who's looking at how surgeons make under stress can make decisions. And one of the things that she says is that really that finding that decompressive mm-hmm. hobby or some form of stress relief is critically important.
We're talking to Art Williams. He is the author of The Surgeon's Obol. He's a general surgeon, and he wrote the excerpt from that book, The First Night on Call as a Surgery Intern. Art, for those medical students who are interested in surgery, what's your number one tip for them as they consider the profession?
I think it's very important to find a program where you get well-rounded training, but also not skipping out on the other things in life. I think for me, surgery mm-hmm. has been a way to have a fulfilled profession and have a really great sense of self and sense of accomplishment each day, but then at the same time, not being overwhelmed. So finding that work and play balance is incredibly important. And things I tell my residents, you know, things like taking up a musical instrument, learning to play the mm-hmm. piano is fantastic stress relief. And it also does something neurologically. So we do a fair amount of robotic surgery, and learning to manipulate, say, your left hand without thinking about it is something that's beautifully accomplished in music. And carries over into surgery. And even if it doesn't carry over into surgery, you've learned to play the piano. You know, sure. There's so many outlets online and things like that to be able to kind of teach yourself something like that. So that that kind of thing to being a well-rounded kind of Renaissance surgeon, where maybe you're learning a language, maybe you're traveling to France, maybe you're learning to play a new instrument. Those things are critically important, in my opinion, and it makes a happy surgeon, it makes a relaxed surgeon, and it makes, you know, probably improves your outcomes because you're just, and it improves your demeanor, and people are just happier to be around you.
Sure. And my final question, do you have a take-home message that you want to share with the KevinMD audience?
Perhaps for the residents that are coming through and interested in this kind of in writing and decompressing in that way, start a journal. I wish I had done that. The book that I wrote has, I could write 10 more probably just based on the patients that I've forgotten about during training. And there's a gold mine of great stories in the oncology ward, in the burn unit, in the trauma base. Sit down and write. I know it's hard when you don't have a lot of time, but when you can, it'll be a great crown jewel to go back and read that, you know, 30 years later, even if you don't publish it, or even if you don't do anything with it, it'll be a timeless treasure if you're able to do something like that.
Art, thank you so much for sharing your insight and time, and thanks again for being on the show.
Hey, appreciate it, Kevin. Thanks very much.